Welcome everybody to our Science at Sugarlands. And we do have Dr. Tom Powers to talk about nematodes today. But I also just wanted to let y'all know a little bit about Discover Life in America. We are a small nonprofit in Gatlinburg, and we are the science partner of the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. Our mission is connecting communities and scientists, discovering, understanding, and conserving biodiversity in the natural world. And we do the Science at Sugarlands every month on Fridays, the third Friday of the month. So we've got one coming up on Friday, September 16th, on the Spring Wildflower Pilgrimage, 72 years of public education in the Smokies with Joey Shaw from University of Tennessee. So definitely make sure that you tune in then. And we are super excited to talk about some nematodes and why they are so amazing. And Dr. Tom Powers is going to start with telling us some 10 amazing facts.
10 amazing facts starting off. Okay. All right. Number one, amazing fact. So the most abundant multicellular animal on the planet. Okay. That's one thing that we should be aware of. There's actually a paper that tried to calculate the number, and these are just terrestrial. They didn't go into the marine nematodes, but they came up with this 4.4 times 10 to the 20 nematodes. And then they calculated the number of gigatons of biomass that might be and put it in some sort of other perspective. A perspective that I sort of like is that if nematodes were pets, you know, and everybody got a pet nematode relative to the number of out there, you could have 57 million nematode pets, each individual. Okay, that's the number of nematodes versus the number of people. So lots and lots of nematodes out there. Okay, nematodes are very old. Okay, most calculations put them back 500 million years ago, and they were clearly among those organisms that first emerged from the seas. But you know, it's kind of fun in some ways. I don't know how many of you remember Jurassic Park or Jurassic Park and all the follow-ups, but the whole idea of Jurassic Park, remember, was getting DNA out of a mosquito that was in amber, and then, you know, mosquito presumably fed on the dinosaur and they were able to recreate the dinosaurs. Well, actually that was sort of based on at least Michael Crichton cites this George Poynar, who was a Berkeley nematologist who liked to study nematodes in amber. And as you can see here, there's a kind of a fly with a relatively large nematode parasite coming out of it. This is the mosquito that I think may have featured in Jurassic Park. But, again, nematodes have been around a long time. If there were little golden books of nematodes, I mean, you would have seen nematodes at each of those, major stages in sort of evolutionary history here. Okay. And also, nematodes are probably not only the most abundant, but inhabit most habitats found on Earth. As a matter of fact, a colleague of mine just wrote a paper on a location in the Antarctic, in the Antarctic Mountains, where they found essentially no nematode life and practically no life at all. I mean, that was such a noteworthy finding. Not finding nematodes and not finding life. But, you know, you can go to the deep seas, some of these deep trenches, and there's a figure here where, in some of these vents, you'll have nematodes that are coated with these sulfur oxidizing bacteria, as many as 6,000 in 10 cc's of substrate. So that's, there's a lot of nematodes down in the deepest parts of the ocean. The Arctic tundra and the temperate forests and up in the Arctic are the habitats that probably have the most nematodes. The greatest abundance anyway. And that's a little surprising because people think sometimes that it's really the rainforests. And we have studied the nematodes in the rainforest, and surprisingly, the soils of the rainforest have often been sort of viewed as being depauperate in terms of nematode numbers, you know. And that was actually worthy of a NSF proposal that we got funded, where we hypothesized that, well, you shouldn't be looking just in the soils. Why don't you look where all the biomass is, which is up in the trees? And sure enough, when you go up into the trees, there's lots of nematode diversity up there, and lots of nematodes. I study nematodes in the prairie a lot, because we're kind of surrounded by, you know, what's left of the tallgrass prairie. And it's sometimes people hypothesize that the prairies were perhaps one of the most diverse areas, just because of the large number of plant species. And a lot of nematodes are closely associated, those that parasitize or feed on plants or feed on the fungi that are associated with the roots. That's again a good habitat to find lots of nematodes. And then the final one I've got here is the nematodes being recently discovered deep down, a couple miles down in the mine shafts, and apparently they've been there for quite a while and have evolved. And a colleague, this Byron Adams, has been part of kind of verifying that these are unique, and he's even quoted as saying they've named this thing Metaphisto species. But anyway, yeah, okay, so nematodes are everywhere. Nematodes are, So you know, there's all this bit about recreating mammoths and recreating, Tasmanian tigers, I think, is one of the most recent things. Well, we've already actually thawed out nematodes from Siberian ice, and now again, since nematodes have this ability, this so-called cryptobiosis or anhydrobiosis, this particular study, which required initially a little verification, but it has just recently been verified that yes, indeed, these nematodes have been thawed out of the permafrost, at least 42,000 years old, and they were able to revive them. So that's quite remarkable. From I have actually been part of a group these are little wheat seeds here, and there was there's a nematode, and it used to be a real agricultural problem that the nematodes would get into the seed head, and then they would dry up, go into anhydrobiosis. And this is an example of what happens when you put water on those seeds later, and they would kind of spring to life. But we worked with some seeds that were in a jar for over 50 years, and we were able to revive them. Okay, and that used to be a big problem, because people would save their wheat seed and then go out and you would end up spreading the nematode about. Okay, they're tough. Nematodes are in some pretty extreme habitats. Recently down there at Mono Lake, they recovered these nematodes in these kind of substrates that have arsenic levels at 500 times the human lethal dose. What's kind of odd about this is that nematodes are often used as models for human development, and so there's a lot of genes that are in common with nematodes, but humans cannot stand the level of arsenic, or for that matter the tremendously high pH that some of these lakes undergo. We ourselves have worked with some high pH alkaline lakes in western Nebraska that get up to 10.5 pH. So again, hot springs in Yellowstone, early on they found nematodes are feeding on some of those thermophile bacteria. So you go to the most extreme environments, and I was lucky to have a trip down into the dry valleys of Antarctic, where you find that actually top of the food chain, again, we're talking about getting away from the coast where all the seals and penguins are and all that. And really the top animal out there are nematodes. I mean, there's no plants there. And I think I should, oh yeah. So here's the only video that I'll show. And actually there's lab chatter there in the back. Oh, there's some tardigrades right there. See, they're just struggling. They're on their back. They can't get any sort of purchase in this little glass plate here. The nematodes are sort of moving about in characteristic nematode. And there's some rotifers that are spinning about. Those long chains, there's a cyanobacter bacteria that are form those colonies or these rather large balls. These are more rotifers going along. And I think that's it for my nematodes. Yeah, so that's actually the a plant community taken from the soil, just as you see over there on the right. It's hardly warrants the description of soil. This is rocky gravel area that we take little spades and put the nematodes into the these cups and take them back to the lab and kind of extract them by various means. Okay, and I mentioned that nematodes are a model. Actually, they were the first multicellular animal to be completely sequenced, and that was a big effort worthy of several Nobel Prizes, actually. And through that effort, they learned, because part of the sequencing effort was accompanied by actually developing what they called a cell fate map, so that one of those people that earned the Nobel Prize spent years on the end of a microscope just watching one cell divide to two, and those two cells divide again and again. And they developed this map that pretty much would tell you where that cell would eventually end up. And so there were other associated discoveries along with it. But in terms of this model nematode, Caenorhabditis elegans, they discovered that there's 59 cells, somatic cells, associated with the nematode. There are also a fair number of reproductive cells, 100 million base pairs generally for your typical nematode, which is, you know, a lot less than the gigabytes of base pairs that you find in gigabase pairs in humans, and about 20,000 genes, which is not far off from the number of genes that humans have and need. So number of interesting findings. Okay, here is a lot of nematodes. This is one of my favorite symbiotic examples here. And we have, and I'm probably sure that it might be in this park, surrounding the park down there, if you have non-native pine trees. Okay, so this is an insect vectored nematode called Bursaphalancus xylophilus, or the pine wilt nematode. And it's got this fascinating life cycle where the beetle, when it emerges from a dead tree, goes through something called maturation feeding. So it immediately feeds on a fresh tree. Around Nebraska, this is around April or so. And in its feeding, it injects, or the nematodes sort of hop off, come out of spiracles actually, and they go right into the tree. Now the nematodes then go through the vessels there and feed on some of the cells. However, the tree quickly becomes stressed, and the stress attracts the various bark beetles. And the bark beetles come with this blue stain fungus. The blue stain fungus starts to invade the tree. The nematodes actually also feed on the blue stain fungus. And then the tree dies, and I'm sure 70-year-old pine tree will die within a couple of months. That tree dies, and then the nematode, the nematode is still in those vessels, but the beetle comes back and needs a dead tree to you know, oviposit on. And that's how the cycle sort of continues. And nematodes eventually will find their way to the galleries of the beetle and hop on the beetle for the next generation. Okay, now nematodes are widely used as sort of biopesticides now, and I would say widely used in Europe and areas that have replaced a lot of their pest organic or inorganic chemicals that use to control them. And so this is a commercial formulation. I mean, there are outfits in Europe, where you'll see them, these vats producing nematodes, and they're the size of grain silos, actually. So, and I think that if you go down your garden, local garden shop, you can probably buy some of these, you know, entomopathogenic nematodes, or we call them EPNs, that actually, it's the fact that they have a symbiotic relationship with a bacterium that kills the a grub or any of this, you know, the soil and inhabiting stage, you know, goes into a pupae or something, and you can get as many as you know, 500,000 nematodes being developed in some of these you know, larvae. Anyway, it injects the bacterium, the nematodes reproduce inside that dying and dead larvae, that insect larvae, and then they go into a sort of a what we call a dour stage, and they'll wait for the next opportunity to infect an insect. And so you can, you know, there's several different kinds of formulations that you can actually just put them into your sprayer. Out here, they're talking about putting them into center pivot systems and spraying about. And there's certain reasons you may or may not want to do that. Okay, and then finally, yes, nematodes are intrinsically appealing looking, okay? I mean, again, maybe not as cute as tardigrades, but here we're looking at a number of nematode faces. Some of them have these sort of protrusions on the head that actually kind of resemble an egg beater, and the thinking is that these bacterial feeders go around and you know, maybe stir up what's inside of a soil pore or in a moss area, and then they're able to channel the bacteria into their gut. Nematodes do have heads, and I'll go into a little bit of the nematode biology here, but what we see is the head. Some of them have little extensions in their sensilla that are generally mechanosensory. There's a pair of chemosensory organisms that for marine forms get to be incredibly, you know, ornate, big spirals, circles, all kinds of, you know, various conformations.
This comes down to what is a nematode, all right? And sometimes you'll hear people talk about, well, nematodes are a tube within a tube, which is essentially referring to their cuticle, which is you know, both a protective, but also they sort of breathe through their cuticle. They don't have any sort of respiratory system. They actually have gas exchange through the And I should instead of saying they're just a tube within a tube, the other tube would be their sort of entire gut system. For a typical plant parasitic nematode here, you can see on the side here, this is a stylet, which is, again, essentially a tube, like a hypodermic needle. It's got a lumen, and the nematode's got some muscles that will contract, and they'll stick that into a plant cell, and then it has a... Here's a sort of a pumping valve that allows the nematode to actually, you know, suck out the contents of a plant cell, and then some glandular parts to this sort of pharynx. And then you just work yourself back into a long intestinal system, and, you know, an anus. So it's got an oral opening and then the anal opening through which the food goes. That's the tube within a tube. Okay, now there's another tube in there, which is the reproductive system. What else? The nematodes tend to have only longitudinal muscles. There's no circular muscles, and that's sort of the character, gives them that sort of characterized whipping side-to-side snake-like movement. They do have a digestive system, nervous system, muscular system, excretory system, and reproductive system. Okay, there you go. And that's so most of you have probably heard of nematodes more from the animal parasites. You know, obviously there's something like 60, 70 different species that will infect humans. You don't hear about them as much as we used to, but pinworms, most people have probably experienced nematodes at one point in their life and not realized it. A colleague of mine got hookworm down in the tropics, crawling around sampling nematodes. You can get, you know, some of these. It's not too difficult still to contract some of these
animal parasites. This is one, though, I like to kind of highlight here, this Romanomyrmus culicivorax. Before there was BT, there was Skeeter Doom. And this is a nematode that will actually, in the when mosquitoes are laying their eggs on the surface of water, these particular nematodes will invade them and actually, you know, they become relatively long nematodes. And so here you see these nematodes coiled up inside the thorax of these larval mosquitoes, and they'll kill them. And so again, it was it's out there in nature. They tend to favor kind of clean water, so that's not so great for mosquitoes that like to occupy dirtier water. But nonetheless, that was an early biocontrol effort. Now, okay, diversity of nematodes. Basically, you can kind of break them into certain kinds of feeders. A rough group is predators. So these are the guys that are going around eating, other nematodes, small mites, small tardigrades, other soil organisms. Some of them are equipped with some pretty hefty teeth inside their stoma, so they can help them rip through the cuticle of a nematode or another organism. Plant parasites, as I've shown before, have got these hypodermic needle-like stylets, most of them. You have fungal feeders that also have stylets, but not so elaborate as the plant feeders, because they don't have to go very deep to suck out the contents of a fungus. And then lots of different bacterial feeders that many of them have these grinding components of their pharynx that allow them to grind up bacteria. Now, okay, and variation on plant, I just like to point out that these stylets are also designed sometimes for the kind of food they eat. For this guy, this is a Xenocricanamella. It's a part of the group that I do most of my studies on, has a long flexible stylet. It feeds on oaks. And I assume that long stylet helps it get through all that sort of epidermis part on the root and gets down into the feeding cell. So it'll spend its life plugged into oak roots. As opposed to this little guy, which is a kind of so-called lesion nematode. It's got a short, powerful stylet, but it actually doesn't need to have a long stylet because it actually burrows into the roots and then migrates through the root system as a migratory endoparasite, as we say. Okay, there are life cycles. Nematodes are molting organisms. They fall into that big group of, just like arthropods, into organisms that do molt. So you have various stages, juveniles hatching out of these eggs, and the eggs are one of the only areas where you have chitin in there in the eggshell. Juveniles then become adults. And here on this particular slide, you can see that here's actually the face and the head of a nematode molting, and you can actually see its oral openings and some of its sensory organs there. Now, okay, so most nematologists are involved with plant parasitic nematodes, and so, a lot of them are endoparasites. We have some quarantinable nematodes that get in just inside. So next time you're cutting up a potato or something that you're growing, you might see sometimes these little dots just by the on the inside, not very far from the skin of the potato. And so doesn't really harm you in any way, shape, or form. It adds little protein to your diet. These are just, again, some of the symptoms of nematodes on potatoes. And of course, these are symptoms on other crops. This is a particularly nasty group called the root knot nematodes, and it's probably one of the major pest species in the world. And and actually what they do is they go inside and they induce a gall, essentially. And then they feed on that gall, and next generations they'll lay eggs in there, and so you'll get many nematodes inside these roots. Okay, and then there's a whole other group called the cyst nematodes, and in this particular case, this big ball here is actually the last stage of the female nematode. She's shooting out a whole mess of eggs there, but when she dies, she actually becomes this hardened case, which, you can put in it in formalin and a number of, heat it up. It's a tremendous survival stage. And that's the way that this particular nematode is able to move with agricultural commodities. This is the soybean cyst nematode. And many, many, many of my colleagues are working in ways of trying to control this particular nematode. And there are nematodes that will infect the above ground parts of plants as well. And particularly in the tropics, but you know, also in temperate areas where we get some of these nematodes. And you might see this in some of your horticultural stores at times, you know, if you or in your growing where the nematodes actually, at least for one species anyway, kind of are demarcated by the veins in the leaves. But you can take that off and put it in a drop of water and all these nematodes will just pour out. So now we get around to why study them and essentially why I study them in the Great Smokies. Because one of my main interests is trying to understand why nematodes are where they are. I mean, we know there's lots of them, but we really don't know how they're distributed across the face of the earth. So there are these two kind of opposing theories. You know, one is that all these little organisms, you know, everything is everywhere theory. You know, they're small enough to be blown around in the wind, and you know, some of them have survival stages. So you know, if there's a hospitable place for them, then they're eventually going to be there. The other theory, I guess, is that the nematodes are actually kind of quite localized. And if you could go in and identify every single nematode underneath a footprint, you might find that there are nematodes there that are not found anywhere else or you know, locally endemic. So, you know, which one is it? You know, what does the evidence suggest? And you know, if you focus your attention on agricultural pests, yeah, it really supports this idea that nematodes pests are just about everywhere. A lot of them they're pests because they can move around well, and they move around with our agricultural commodities, and they've been doing that as long as there's been agriculture. So soybean cyst nematode shows up in North America, 1954, and now it's spread everywhere where soybeans are grown. Okay, root knot nematodes, you know, and actually one species of root knot nematode is found in just about every country that has got, a seasonal growing climate that you know, it doesn't get too cold in the winter. This is sort of a tropical nematode, but everywhere down south, you'll see root knot nematodes in particular. And again, these are the galls of the root knot nematodes. But if you go down to the Arctic or Antarctic here, you know, there are only in the dry valleys just three different species, and they are found nowhere else other than the dry valleys. But that's a remote location, and you might say, well, you know, they've evolved there, and you know, yeah, it's been a while since there's been any other movement. It's still a very pristine place. But you know, if you go down into the tropics, and like I said before, you know, a lot of that diversity is up there in the trees, but then you'll find that nematodes are found in the bromeliads, and there's unique nematodes that are adapted just for life within that sort of water in the bromeliads. So again, they partition those niches very, very carefully. So Great Smoky Mountains, wonderful thing about studying Great Smoky Mountains is again, the ATVI, I'll mention that. So we had a project for 3 or 4 years where we were kind of going around the US and sampling nematodes. And we really are interested in the Great Smoky Mountains because of this ATBI site, which was set up by, you know, essentially E.O. Wilson and a lot of very forward-thinking people. And they had this wonderful sort of setup where a number of the types of habitats were all replicated. And so, you know, grassy balds and heath balds, high elevation spruce forests. There I'm sampling against one of those old growth tulip trees. Boy, and that's tough sampling. You know, we use a little soil core to get the soil. And in some of those old growth areas, it's just like 99% root. You can't even find the soil with your little soil core, which is, you know, a bit of a problematic. I mean, it's worse than sampling in the Antarctic, where you're just essentially going through rock. Anyway, there's those beach gap forests, the old field, and then the kind of the secondary mid-elevation And okay, so I'm just going to pull out one nematode in particular that exhibits what we've found in the Smokies, and that's going up there to Brushy Mountain. And there's a colleague of mine, Peter Mullen, who actually was on this particular that was really kind of tall vegetation there, and he'd pop up like one of those whack-a-mole type things, and it'd pop up, and then he's down on the ground trying to get some soil. But in that area, we described a nematode. This is just new to science. We called it Mesocrycanema ericaceum. It's just one of these nematodes that falls into this family of about 900 different species have been described, but they're very, very common in the Smokies. So this, we just described this one, ericaceum, because it was pretty much all this ericaceum, like, blueberries, rhododendrons, that kind of vegetation. And then that's not the only nematode in this group that we also found in that habitat. There's two others that have very different distributions, which I kind of, so this is, I would like to show you here. And this is, Cryconema lufi and Ogma seymouri, and these are the distributions. Okay, so Ogma seymouri. Now these are all found in the Great Smokies, and what I'm showing you here is so this is kind of stands for the Great Smokies. Each one of those numbers is an individual number nematode that we have looked at. We photographed it, and then we did a DNA barcoding. So depicted here is a DNA barcoding, what we call a network. And so these nematodes are related to these by one, two mutational steps. And these are other mutational steps here. Okay, so this particular nematode goes all the way up to, we found this species, in addition to the Great Smokies and Brushy Mountain, we find it up at a rhododendron area, and we found it down in Alaska, and again, lots of them in the Smokies. Here's another one, also in Brushy Mountain. It's not found further north than the Great Smokies, but it is found along the coasts, along the Gulf Coast, and it's again, probably part of some ancient the other distribution. We have compared other relic, glacial relic areas, which is, we're considering the Smokies glacial relic, place where organisms hung out back in, when they were pushed down here by the glaciers. We've looked in the, this is the big thicket down in southeastern part of Texas. And so this is the kind of habitats they have there, but they also have lots of these nematodes that are of the group we found. And I think, I'll see if I can move this down a little bit. I don't know, there's something, I can't see the number there. If it's somewhere around 60 some of these nematodes that are found in the two glacial relic areas, but only four species are shared between one glacial relic area and another. So that means that there's a tremendous amount of unique or endemic species that you can find in the Smokies. And there are other mysteries. You go up into Andrew's Bald, and it looks like a normal grassland, but it doesn't have anything in way, shape, or form that makes it look like, from the below ground part as a grassland. Very, very different, say, from Missouri glades or Nebraska prairies that we look at, which those will look like each other, but again, nothing like Andrew's Bald. So that's, to me, is a mystery, and I'd like to see a lot of go into other places. Now I'm going to leave you here with this one. This will be my last slide, and it leaves you with this sort of idea that, and this is not my idea, it was Cobb's idea, but it's kind of this quote that used to be in all these invertebrate books that, if you could eliminate all the matter on Earth except nematodes, then you could be this, as he likes to say, disembodied spirit floating over that. You'd be able to recognize mountains, hills, vales, and all that. You'd be able to recognize humans because of their specific human parasites and animals because of their specific parasite. And all I would say right now is that we can pretty much verify that. And on the molecular level, we're finding that there's a lot more specificity. We could actually probably say from just looking at the nematode community in some soil coming from the Great Smokies that yes, it came from the Great Smokies, and it most likely came from a bald or a beech forest or something like that. So that's kind of a neat idea. And then I need to thanks again to, you know, a lot of this work is funded by National Science Foundation, Park Service. Always appreciate all the help we get from DLiA, and Big Thicket also has a group that does sort of the same kind of stuff. So I will stop there. And you know, the fun part is usually taking questions from anybody. That's the lousy part of this Zoom stuff. But anybody want a question about? I've kind of covered a lot of territory here. Nematodes.
Yeah. I'm looking to see if anybody's. I have a quick question because you had mentioned on some of the emails how you got into studying nematodes. And so I think it would just be kind of interesting for some folks to hear a little bit about kind of what you got, what got you on this path.
Studying nematodes?
Yes. Yeah.
Okay, so I was a entomology major as an undergraduate at Purdue University, and I really had no, I just like to collect insects. I had no idea what an entomologist does, or, you know, I collected insects. My senior year, I took a course in which actually from a woman that, by the name of Virginia Ferris, who passed away this couple of years ago, but she was one of the sort of the leading thinkers in nematology, and she liked to talk about the nematode parasites of insects, because we had a session where we'd sit down in the lab and we'd cut open, you know, like a bark beetle or something like that, or you know, Bessie beetle. And then we would look inside the gut. And inside the gut, there would be these nematodes swimming along. And she would point out that, oh, it's not only that one nematode, but there's another nematode that's you know, partitioned off in a different part of the gut. And there are all these adaptations to life living in the gut. And so that, I just kind of like that, you know, that Russian dolls thing, or the, you know, organism with inside another organism. And the irony, I guess, I don't know if it's irony, but what's amazing to me is, you know, now we study nematodes by whole genome sequencing. And we're sequencing, actually they can sequence a whole genome of an individual nematode now. I mean, it's quite incredible. But that technology has demonstrated or shown or provided evidence that nematodes have their own internal parasites and or own internal biota. You know, not necessarily parasites, but they are living within the gut. And some of these are fungal single-celled other single-celled organisms, and they are viruses as well. But this was not known until we really started to look deeply inside the insides of a nematode. So they're more boxes within boxes.
No, that's great. It's definitely taken you on some pretty cool adventures. So, yeah. And especially with the ATBI, you know, all of us at Discover Life in America appreciate all of the scientists during those beginning days out getting all of the specimens and all the research that went into it.
The old growth hemlock forests aren't exactly what they were at the time that those plots were set up, but now
very true
raspberry patches. It's just a wonderful setup.
Absolutely. We have another great question too. Let me remember who said this. Christopher asks, since nematodes are so specific, can they or have they been used in forensics to determine like a location of death?
Yeah. Yes. That's an area that's always kind of developing, because now there's two reasons for that. You know, one is that most of the flies and beetles that come to a dead cadaver come at a certain time. So, you know, you obviously use insects. They also bring nematodes as well. And then the nematodes go through a sort of a successional period. And we've actually worked with some of these folks, some of the forensics people, to, you know, where we put out pigs and you kind of follow how long, the successional, you know, at first you get the bacterial feeders and then the fungal feeders and then predators loaded. And so it is a real resource. And we've studied actually bison out on the prairie. And, you know, when bison die, there's all this biomass that's released in it, and they have the kind of kill a lot of the vegetation out there. And you can kind of study these death sites and how they recover as well, and kind of get an idea of how long it takes for them to, you know, when did that bison die? So, mm-hmm. so that's a good question, because, you wouldn't necessarily think of that, but you know, that's... there is forensic nematology. And by the way, I noticed that you said, you know, you can call them nematodes or you can call them nematodes. It doesn't much matter. In the States, we tend to be calling nematodes, and Europeans were more nematodes. And...
Mm-hmm. Tomato, tomato.
Right, exactly.
Any other questions? You can feel free to put them in the chat, or if you want to jump on camera or audio, you're welcome to do that as well.
I have a question. I am curious. You talked about like the nematodes living in the gut of a bark beetle. I'm just wondering how common like specificity is nematode specificity in terms of like different insect species or other.
Actually, this is an argument I like to engage with my entomology colleagues, because, you know, they always are saying, well, really, you know, insects are the most diverse organisms, and I'll kind of counter that by saying, well, you know, every termite species has got its own termite nematode parasite. So, you know, in that particular case, it's kind of a one-for-one deal there. So, you know, so I would suspect most insects all have a, you know, I don't want to say all, but, you know, most insects do have nematode parasites associated with them. Some of them have broader host range than others, but specificity is, you know, again, a lot of nematodes are tied into just that very specific life cycle. Yeah.
I have a question that builds on that one, if I might.
Uh-huh.
Can you genetically alter a nematode then to be a vector of something if you want to control a given population of some other animal?
Yeah, so you can transform nematodes. Most of the research in that area is going focused on agricultural pests. And you know, similar to the, you know, you make these mosquitoes that can't mate or something like that, you know, and if you have nematodes that require mating, then, you know, you try and make sterile males type things. You can alter them. Transformation of nematodes is kind of at early stage. So I don't know of anybody that has been able to, say, alter the host range of a parasitic form, you know. Yeah, but I'm sure that's is possible. I mean, with the new genetic tools that people have, you ought to be able to put various genes and modifiers in there.
Yeah, I was thinking, and non-agriculture, I was thinking more of things like being able to mitigate things like our recent experience with COVID. If we identify, say, if it was a specific bat, say, species, that was an issue as the original point of origin of this particular
yeah.
Viral infection. Could we figure out a way to genetically modify a nematode to be able to take on and encounter where that is, that not defect, but that evolution is in a community, say, of bats?
Yeah, no, I'm not aware of any research, but it's not as far-fetched of an idea as you would think. I mean, in the sense that there are nematodes that are designed for that can exist within specific habitats, and in my experience, there are nematodes that interact with viruses. I mean, there are nematodes that transmit viruses, but there are also nematodes that actually enhance viral infection. Now I'm thinking though, these are aquatic systems and it has nothing to do with COVID, but there are, and these are kind of complicated interactions, but they all kind of relies on a nematode eating an organism like a paramecium that might have a symbiotic chlorella algal cell in it that also by the feeding the nematode releases these virus that infect the algal cell, and so in this case a nematode actually is a enhances the number of virus within a lake. I mean, these are complex interactions, but we're just learning about this sort of thing. So I again, manipulation of the nematode's host range and all that is I think a ways off. We have a lot more to understand about just why they are able to feed on one organism versus another at this point. And that's an amazing thing about nematodes. It's supposedly they think there might be, 1 to 2 million species out there that are undescribed. And we don't know what they eat. We don't know what they do, and it's just amazing. It's that there's so much unknown in this particular area. Oh, best way this is a chat here. Best way for students in the lab class to collect and see nematode diversity. Okay, so we've done this before on the, we've done down at the great, actually down there in the, in the Smokies and near the Twin Creeks area. But that's Sugarlands, right? Is that the your little lab facilities down there?
Twin Creeks, near Sugarland.
Twin Creeks, yeah. Anyway, okay, so what you need is a microscope. It's easy to get nematodes out of the soil, really. I mean, one thing you can do, the better way is to use sieves, and you can collect nematodes on sieves if you have a series of sieves, but it's inexpensive way. You can put them on funnels. Okay, and so you can, like sieve off the really coarse substrate material, and on a relatively fine sieve, you can then take some of that substrate and just put it on a regular funnel. I guess a good piece of, if you go down to a gas station and get the kind of wipes that they use for cleaning your windshield, that has the perfect porosity as a kind of a holder of nematode, kind of the substrate soil. And if you get it wet and there's a wet connection between that and the stem of the, the glass funnel, and then you can kind of cap off the bottom, and over a course of say 24 hours or so, the nematodes will just filter their way down through the funnel, through the substrate and through the filter paper. And then they're clean, and you need a good, a decent dissecting microscope to see nematodes. And another thing about looking at nematodes is that dissecting microscopes that kind of the old fashioned type that have the sort of the mirror, and you're able to kind of focus light up from the bottom. Those are the best kind of microscopes to view them with, these LED, a lot of these new microscopes, you don't get as good of transparency. I mean, nematodes are transparent. You can see all the cells and inside their organisms, and it's why they were studied as a developmental biology model. So if you have a good dissecting microscope with the reflecting mirror putting light up through a glass plate below them, you can see a lot of the characteristics that I talked about today. Then a light microscope, you can run up, 400x and see, cell nuclei and everything else. So yeah, and someone said, yes, Kleenex does work well as a filter for nematodes. And actually following after the people that the parasitologists that just used to take human feces and put them on pie plates with a supported screen and let the nematodes and other organisms just work their way out through the substrate and into the water underneath it. I forgot to say, nematodes are aquatic animals. They need water to respire and to live. If there's no water, they can't breathe. Most of them or those that can will go into an anhydrobiotic survival stage and wait for there's water around them. So they are legitimately aquatic animals. Anything else? Any other? The biggest nematode, the 8-meter long parasite of whale. I've sort of skipped all those other amazing facts, but that's for another talk.
Yeah, well, I just want to say hello and thank you for the talk. I'm not a scientist by any means. My formal education ended in high school. Mm-hmm. So I'm following along a little bit because I fairly intelligent, but. I was curious about this conversation because as a young man in my mid-20s, I worked for a pest control company in South Florida. Mm-hmm. And we sprayed lawns for nematodes. Mm-hmm. And they would like damage the root systems, mm-hmm. the grasses.
Yeah.
But I had no idea of the diversity of nematodes. I thought they were just like a South Florida problem.
No.
And I'm totally fascinated that they're like everywhere. And
yeah,
I just come on here because I'm kind of like a self-educated person and I love listening to people that actually know what they're talking about.
Yeah.
It's just this wonderful experience and to come to understand that these creatures are so diverse. It's just like, it's blowing me away.
Yeah. No. And sit out on your lawn, put your hand in the soil, and you can pull up a little handful of soil, and you've got your several thousand nematodes in there. So, it is relatively remarkable that, and again, that problem that you're talking about in Southern Florida on the lawn on the turf, that still exists. And in golf courses, it's a major, major problem. And the trouble is that they got themselves kind of on this pesticide treadmill that you've got to spray every so often just to keep that turf and that grass and that, in the condition particularly that golfers like to have. And so you can't have the dying out of those grasses on the greens that mess up your putts. So, well, thanks. I could talk all day about nematodes, but.
Thanks, Dale. That was great. And we've got time for one more question. And Elizabeth's asking how climate change affects nematodes.
Whoa, that's the big, that's one of the big
questions. That could take a little while to get into, huh?
Yeah, but it's actually we're all writing our grants where we're bringing in climate change in part because I talked about those root knot nematodes that cause all that damage on carrots and things. Well, what limits them is winter temperatures up further north. Okay, if the climate is more hospitable to the suddenly we have those the worst nematodes moving further north from a agricultural perspective. It's definitely going to bring in, climate change is going to bring in a whole new suite of agricultural pests. In part because we're going to be doing agriculture a little bit differently. Here we just grow corn and soybeans and wheat out west. We might be able to grow some other crops here, economically, but, we'll have to deal with their pests, which we don't have right now. So, that's if somebody's looking for a job, you somehow get into some sort of modeling where you can make some predictions about what's going to happen with climate change.
Yeah.
Or lack of water. Or too much water, however you want to look at it.
We've definitely had our fair share of water this summer in the Smokies. Thank you so much, Tom, because this has been very educational for me too, because I knew a little bit about nematodes and a lot of the microscopic organisms in our soil and our water, but I am fascinated by the diversity, what we can learn from them. As a gardener, I love learning about the different things that are important to have in my soil, but also just what is out everywhere around me. So I think it's something that we've all learned a little bit today about it. Maybe they're not as cute as tardigrades, but I think we should give the nematodes like a new reputation. Like maybe they're like the punk rock of the molting organisms, They're not like, they do their own thing. It's been fun to hear you talk about them. And again, we really appreciate everything you've done with the All Taxa Biodiversity Inventory, which I also feel like there might be some folks not familiar with that. I'm Jamie with Discover Life in America. We are a nonprofit organization that is a science partner of the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. And our flagship study is, our flagship project is the All Taxa Biodiversity Study, in which we've been naming and describing all of the things and species we can find in the Great Smoky Mountains National Park. We have added 10,654 species to the park number. So we're over 21,000 species at this point. 1,052 of them are new to science. And this project all started in 1998, 25 years ago. So stay tuned from Discover Life in America, because we are bringing a bunch of fun events to you for our 25th anniversary next year. So.
Okay, yeah. Well, it's great work that you're doing and all, great to spread the word. Science.
Absolutely.
Is real.
And if any of y'all did join late, we will have this on YouTube, our YouTube channel. So you can catch the whole thing. We'll have it posted early next week. And we'd love to hear if you have anything else that you'd like to share.
Okay. All right. Well, yeah. Take care then. I'm going to stop my sharing here.
All right.
And
well, thanks much again.
Yeah, people should feel free to email me if they have any nematode questions, because I teach nematodes. I have to start teaching next week, so it's always something new to talk about. So.
Well, okay. I know I absolutely love seeing people who are doing what they love to do and learning about something they're super passionate about. So it's been really fun to hear from you, and thanks so much. And I hope everyone has a great day, and join us next time for our Science at Sugarlands.